Good morning. Welcome home to Trinity, a place of sharing the gospel and growing God's family. And a warm welcome to our guests today. So happy that you're with us. Before we get into today's service, just a few announcements. After church today and the next Sunday also, in the fellowship hall by the kitchen side, if you haven't done it yet, be sure to go over there and check the data that we have on you and your family. Address, email, cell phone, birth dates, things like that. We've switched over to this new software called Church Community Builder, and we want to make sure it is as accurate as possible. Also, a reminder, in 2 weeks, we begin our Trinity Treehouse and Trinity Timbers program, our new name for Sunday school. And then, good news, Pastor Cook's installation has been set. It is going to be October 27th. End of the month. It'll be at 4 o'clock that Sunday afternoon. And starting next Sunday, there'll be a wooden church out in the entry area for gift cards and welcome gifts, things like that. And then also, Illinois Lutheran School, specifically elementary, is seeking temporary help with the aftercare program. Hours are between 3 and 6 o'clock, Monday to Friday. Kind of a pressing thing. If you're interested or have questions, contact Jeff Falk, the grade school principal, for more information. Today we're continuing our sermon series entitled Next Gen, looking at how we can share Jesus with the next generation. Today the sermon is going to be delivered by Pastor Mike Novotny. I don't know if you know Pastor Novotny. He is part of the Time of Grace Ministry, which is an online and TV ministry program. His church is up in Appleton, Wisconsin. It's called The Core. And the sermon series that we are doing, he also did. Today, specifically, we look at how God uses every one of us, not just parents, fathers, and mothers, but grandparents, aunts, uncles, members of the community, members of the family of believers. God uses a village to reach the next generation with Jesus. So with that in mind, let's begin today with a prayer. Lord Jesus Christ, we know your heart for every generation, for this next generation, that you would be willing to leave the 99 to go look for the one, if that's what it took. Lord, be with us, be with all of us, not just moms and dads, but grandparents, aunts, uncles, friends, all of us as a family of believers, that you may use us to share your salvation with every generation. Bless us today, Lord, to that very end. In your name we pray. Amen. The entire service is printed in the worship folder. It's also going to be on the screens. You can use whichever one you want. Our opening song is Father Welcomes, and with the songs and the entire service, please join in whenever you feel comfortable doing so.
Father welcomes all his children to his family through his Son. Father giving his salvation, life forever has been won. Father welcomes all his children to his family through his Son. Father giving his salvation, life forever has been won. Little children, come to me, for my kingdom is of these. Life and love I have to give, mercy for your sin. Father welcomes all his children to his family through his Son. Father giving his salvation, life forever has been won. In the water, in the word, in his promise be assured. Those who are baptized and believe shall
Please stand for worship. We're gathered here today to worship our holy and triune God, the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit. May He be praised among us this morning. Amen. And as we praise Him, let us humbly first come to Him and join in confessing our sins. Merciful Father in heaven, I am altogether sinful from birth. In countless ways I have sinned against you and do not deserve to be called your child. But trusting in Jesus, my Savior, I pray, have mercy on me according to your unfailing love. Cleanse me from my sins and take away my guilt. My friends, God, our Heavenly Father, has had mercy on us. He gave us His one and only Son, Jesus Christ, into death on the cross to pay for all of our sins. And God, the Holy Spirit, has given us faith and to trust and grasp what Christ has done. And so because of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit, I forgive you all of your sins. Amen. Be seated. Our scripture reading for today is from 2 Timothy chapter 1. And just a few things. It's interesting how things come around again. You know, maybe the older of us remember writing letters, and the first thing you'd write would be to who it's from, and the last thing is you signing it because you wrote it. Well, before that, it was the flip. Before that, you wrote who wrote it first, and then to whom you're writing. That's kind of what it is now, isn't it, with email and text messaging. First thing you see is, who is it from? That's the way it was in Bible times. When a letter was written, the person writing it signed it first. And that's the case here with the second letter that Paul wrote to the young pastor, Timothy. He said, Paul, an apostle of Christ Jesus by the will of God, in keeping with the promise of life that is in Christ Jesus. To Timothy, my dear son. Grace, mercy, and peace from God the Father and Christ Jesus our Lord. I thank God, whom I serve, as my ancestors did, with a clear conscience. As night and day, I continually remember you in my prayers. Recalling your tears, I long to see you so that I may be filled with joy. I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded now lives in you also. For this reason, I remind you to fan into the flame the gift of God, which is in you through the laying on of my hands. For the Spirit God gave us does not make us timid, but gives us power, love, and self-discipline. This is the word of our Lord.
Grace, mercy, and peace to you in Jesus' name. The class of 2021, that's what her t-shirt said. And suddenly this 38-year-old felt very, very middle-aged. I was in the YMCA workout room at about 2:30 doing a workout, and I felt like the young guy who was in the place until about 3 or 3:30 hit, and the next generation flooded. And suddenly I looked around, and at one point I tried to count, and I believe I was the second oldest guy in that weight room. The teenagers, the high school students, the college kids who had just gotten done with class, I looked around and I suddenly felt very, very old. But you know, I tried not to take it personally. I tried instead to remember what we've been learning in this sermon series, that it doesn't matter who you are, what the year of your graduation is, what your age or your generation, that God has this incredible, passionate love to make sure that every generation knows about the forgiveness and the grace of Jesus. And that's so important for all of us to remember, because if you ever studied different generations or just looked around you at people who are older or younger, it's so easy just to notice what's different instead of what's the same. God's passion for the entire world. I know I felt that in the weight room that day. I noticed how young the people looked who were around me. I noticed how differently they used technology as I scribbled my notes in like an old school notebook with a pen. They all got out their smartphones and talked to each other and texted in between sets. It'd be so easy to notice the differences between the generations, but today I want to focus your attention instead on how Jesus feels. No matter what your age, no matter what the year of your high school graduation, let's remember what Jesus taught in Matthew 18. He said, in the same way, your Father in heaven is not willing that any of these little ones should perish. As Jesus thought about the kids, the little ones, the next generation, he said, our Father in heaven is not willing to lose a single one. And so whether you're a teenager or a college student, or you're pushing retirement or middle age, whether you had to be brought here with the help of someone who dropped you at the door, because your final years have come so quickly, God doesn't want to lose any of us. And I think as we get older, you know, it's so easy to notice the difference in the kids at the coffee shop who all have their phones out. It's easy to get frustrated and notice what's different. But instead, I want you to embrace the heart of our Father that never changes. And from generation to generation, he doesn't want to lose a single person. And so in the sermon series, we've talked about that. As a church and as a Christian community, how can we do that to make sure the teenagers and the grade school kids and the 20-somethings have the same passion that so many of their parents and grandparents and great-grandparents have had for Jesus? And just in case you weren't here last year, let me do like a one-sentence review of what took me about 45 minutes to say 7 days ago. It was this, if you're taking notes in your program, that God uses fathers to reach the next generation. Where are all my dads at today? Quick show of hands. Yeah, a bunch of fathers here. If you didn't hear that message, I need you to go back online and check that out. Because God has like given a really special privilege and responsibility, a really sacred calling to dads. When a father doesn't just have like a business plan or retirement plan, but he has a Jesus plan for his kids, I mean, that is where revival happens in a generation. When kids come home and dad's, you know, not just in charge of putting bread on the table, but the bread of life into his children's hearts. When kids get to see not just a dad who wants to check the boxes of like a pre-dinner, pre-bedtime prayer, but a dad who's so passionate about the grace of God. And he cares very, very little about like religion and rules and rituals. He cares so much about the relationship that he himself has with his Father in heaven. That is when kids' hearts are impacted in powerful and incredible ways. So if you're a father here or might be one day, I want you to embrace that. When you die and your kids come to your funeral, they will care so little about your official job position or the amount of dollars in your savings or retirement account. Instead, they will care massively about the faith you had and the Jesus that you passed on. But there's a problem with that, and you probably know it. I mean, scripturally, even statistically, we've seen that the good dads are one of the best ways to pass the faith on to the next generation. But the problem is, not every kid has a great dad. And we can't change that. Some of you didn't grow up with amazing, humble, passionate, Christ-loving fathers. Maybe you grew up in religious households, maybe not. But there's no like big rewind button I can push and go back on life to re-give you that experience. And even as we look out at our friends and our nieces and our nephews and our grandkids and our next door neighbors and our classmates and our teammates, we can't like push some button and change the experience of their home. And there might be some great Christian fathers in our church, but we can't like kidnap all the kids and cram them into those couple homes. The kids won't fit and it just won't work, which is a really, really scary thought. I mean, if this is the number one factor to keep kids connected to Jesus in their 20s, their 30s, and beyond, what happens when lots of kids don't grow up in homes like that? Dr. Gene Twenge is a psychologist from San Diego State who's really studied generation to generation, and she noted that this next generation, what some people call Gen Z, those of you who are in your schooling years up to your low 20s, not only do you tend to be the most irreligious generation in American history, a generation where many people never go to church, never pray, don't even believe in God, you were also the generation who were raised by the least religious and passionate parents. She noted a study that was done that in the late 1970s, only 5% of kids were raised without a Christian parent. But by the year 2016, that number had over tripled to 17%. And I want you to think what that means for 50 years from now in America. If this generation has really been shaped by that 5% that increased, what happens when 17% is the new normal and only gets worse from there? What happens when we're learning that collegiate students and those in even in their high school years at the rates of 30, 40, even 50% don't even believe there is a God? What will happen if we need fathers to raise up their kids, but the fathers themselves have no desire to connect their kids to Jesus because they don't know, love, or trust in him? I mean, in one generation or two, if God blesses me to be a grandpa or a great-grandpa, like what kind of country, what kind of community will my great-grandkids grow up in? Will any of their cousins be Christians? Will any of their classmates? And if not, how can faith survive? Sometimes when I look at the statistics, like I get right to the edge of plummeting into despair and hopelessness for our country's future. I see what's happened just in my lifetime, and it seems like things are only getting worse. I think of what I know about Europe, which once thrived with Christian churches, and now it's almost impossible to talk about God because no one even believes that he exists. And it seems like we are on the fast track to repeating that experience. But just before I take that step over the edge and lose my hope, I open this book. Because there's a little section in this book, the Bible, that gives incredible hope when it seems like we are so close to losing the Christian faith. And it's a part of the Bible that I want to share with you today called the Book of Acts. In case you haven't read it, Acts is really the story of the generation that came after Jesus. The New Testament starts with those four biographies of Jesus, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John. And then Jesus returns to his Father in heaven, and Acts is what comes next. It really tracks the history of Christianity from about 30 AD to 60 AD. And if you start the book of Acts, you should be very, very scared. Because there are only, about 120 people who are Christians. And the people who are running the church, the people who are running the government, are not fans of freedom of religion. They're trying to stamp out this early Christian movement. And yet, by the end of the book, what happens is simply astounding. The Christianity, against all the odds, escapes its little corner of the world in Jerusalem, and it explodes to new countries, new continents. This little church of 100 explodes into thousands until we arrive at where we're at today, 2,000 years later, where Christianity has affected billions and billions of lives around the globe. But here's what I want you to know today about that story. What happens in the book of Acts when that little church explodes and spreads throughout the earth is primarily not because of fathers. As valuable as the Bible says that a good Christian father is, it's not the only way that God works. In fact, in the book of Acts, it's not the usual way that God works. And that's what I want to share with you today, to give you hope and to help you see your role in helping the next generation know how glorious it is to know and trust in God. I want to tell you three stories from the book of Acts. And they're not about fathers. They're about neighbors and strangers. They're about grandmothers and mothers. They're about sinners and sorcerers. Oh yes, if you stay awake to the end of my message, you'll hear about the sorcerers that Jesus used to tell the next generation about Jesus. And I hope at the end of these three stories, you might be inspired to read the entire book of Acts. And I hope as you get to its last chapter, you realize that hope is not gone. And that if all of us embrace our role, we truly can pass on Jesus to the next generation. All right, three stories. Here's the first one. It's about a famous Christian named Paul, who was born with the name Saul. If you know much about Christianity, you might have heard that name. We named churches even in our own city after Paul. He wrote half of the New Testament, 13 or 14 books. He actually gave his life. Church tradition said he had his head chopped off because he refused to give up Jesus. He was that passionate about him. But you might not know that he didn't start that way. His daddy didn't raise him to love Jesus, and his mother didn't either. It wasn't that Paul was an atheist. He was actually very, very passionate about his religion. He was like zealous for his faith, and he was completely convinced that Christianity was dead wrong. And so Paul took on full-time work, and his work was to stamp out the Christian church. He thought God loved it when he became like a religious terrorist, hunted down, arrested Christians, and had them put to death in the name of his God. In other words, this was the last guy that you'd expect to see in church raising his hands in worship to Jesus as the Savior and Son of God. But then the book of Acts, something happened. Paul was marching from Israel up to Damascus in modern-day Syria. He had letters in his hands of people that were known Christians. He was going to arrest them, drag them back, and have them put to death when something happened to Paul. This bright light filled the skies, something he couldn't explain, but he spent his whole life repeating. And this voice boomed from the bright light. The voice said it was Jesus. And Paul's faith got train wrecked. Jesus was dead. He wasn't alive. And he certainly wasn't speaking from a bright light in heaven. Jesus was an imposter and a fake and a fraud. He wasn't the Son of God. And the experience leveled Paul. It actually blinded him. And for 3 days, he stumbled into this rented room and he prayed to his God and he tried to process exactly what had happened. And that's when God tapped a Christian on the shoulder that wasn't Paul's father. Let's let the book of Acts tell this little snippet of the story. Acts 9 says, in Damascus, there was a disciple named Ananias. The Lord called to him in a vision, Ananias. Yes, Lord, he answered. The Lord told him, go to the house of Judas on Straight Street and ask him for a man from Tarsus named Saul, for he's praying. Y'all remember Ananias from the old Sunday school stories? No, you don't. I saw maybe two nodding heads in this whole church because we don't know who Ananias was, right? He wasn't Paul's best friend. He wasn't his relative. Here's who he was. He was the neighbor who just happened to live next door to the guy whose heart God was working on. And there's a powerful word in that sentence. He was the neighbor who lived next door to the guy whose heart God was working on. If you're taking notes in your program, I'd love for you to write that down. It's not just fathers, that God actually uses neighbors to reach the next generation, which is so, so, so important for you to know. Because I have a feeling that you have a neighbor who is a little bit like Saul. A neighbor, a coworker, a classmate, a cousin, you know, someone you work with, someone in your family, one of your classmates who's three lockers down from yours. I bet you know someone who seems like the last person in the world who would ever want to come to church and worship Jesus. Maybe it's a classmate who's always posting like really bold things about church being fake and for hypocrites, and he wants nothing to do with religion. Or maybe it's that classmate who's such a confident atheist and has, you know, 15 reasons why Christianity is dead wrong. Maybe it's that person in your family where they've been really clear, you've tried, you've invited them to Christmas Eve, they're not even coming to that because they have no interest in the God that you worship. And maybe you've given up hope. To which I would say, so did Ananias. If you would have told him that Saul was in a house just on the street, he wouldn't have even knocked on the door. But he had no clue what God was doing in that man's heart. And you don't either. Now, right now, they might not be interested. Right now, baptism might be the last thing from their mind. Right now, praying to Jesus and making him the sun around which their entire life orbits might seem like an impossibility, but you have no clue in this next year what God will do. You have no clue when the car accident happens and they lose their ability to walk and their dreams and their plan for the future. And they're looking, scrambling, falling, trying to find a rock onto which to put their feet. You have no clue when one of your classmates dies and there you are at the funeral and now you can't get past it. People die all the time and sometimes you don't get till age 92. You never know when the breakup or the divorce will happen and their life will be crushed and they'll be searching for unconditional love because they thought they had it and then they lost it. You never know when the addiction will really take its hold and they'll hit bottom and they'll be reaching, calling out for a higher power, for anyone that could forgive them, love them, and accept them about what they've done. Maybe the depression gets worse and the medication stops being effective. And they just need something to give them joy, something to give them hope after everything they've been through. And so right now, it might seem like an impossibility, but you never know what's going to happen tomorrow. You never know when God is going to be working hard on the heart of your neighbor and tap you on the shoulder to reach him. Which is kind of what happened to Francis Collins. You know this guy? Francis Collins is one of the most famous scientists in America. He's currently the head of the Human Genome Research Project. He is a brilliant man who has a degree, I believe, in quantum mechanics from Yale. And for most of his life, Francis Collins was absolutely convinced there was no God. He was a man of facts, a man of science, and a man who had no place for faith. But then something happened. During his medical residency, Francis Collins noticed something about the Christians he witnessed in the hospital, that they suffered in a different way. And it wasn't just because God worked miracles every time they prayed and healed them and they got out of there faster than the atheists in the room next door. It was the way they found hope in God when he didn't heal them. It was the way they didn't get mad at God, but they still trusted he had a plan even when things didn't get better. Is that their family and friends knew that there was a life to come a billion times better than this one, so they didn't have the fear of death that so many others did. And it made Francis Collins curious. And it kind of dawned on him, and I give him so much credit for this, that he realized that he had studied medicine and science so deeply, but he had not done the same thing with the faith. That when it came to Christianity, he just, you know, looked to the worst hypocrites in the church and believed the rumors that he had heard about the contradictions and false things in the Bible. And so he reached out to a neighbor. He went to a Methodist pastor who was the campus minister of the place where he was studying. And according to Collins himself, he came in bold. He admitted saying blasphemous things about Jesus. He made blunt assumptions about the Christian faith. But the pastor was ready for Francis Collins. He didn't kick him out of the office. He didn't tell him he was being disrespectful to the God he worshipped. He simply challenged him to actually read the Bible for himself. He had read 1,000 books. Why not read the best-selling one in the world? He encouraged him also to read the works of C.S. Lewis, a brilliant mind who had once been an atheist too, but when he dug into it, had found something different. And Francis Collins did. And the rest, you could say, is his story. He came to see there was not just incredible design, a creator who had made the world that he had studied, but there was a personal God who had entered that story to forgive the blasphemous things he said and the godless things that he had done. He became a Christian who believed not just in some generic higher power, but in a living personal savior named Jesus. Now, if you would have asked that Methodist minister, do you think you could bring a 27-year-old confident atheist with a Yale degree in quantum physics to faith? Think he would have bet his best Bible on that? No, but he had no idea what happened in those hospital rooms. He had no idea the doubts and questions happening in Francis's heart. And Christians, neither do you. So please, please, please do not retreat inside the church walls. Please don't end friendships with people who don't seem interested at all. Please don't stop loving and investing and going out for coffee and letting your light shine, because you never know when that moment comes and someone sees the light and God taps you on the shoulder to talk about Jesus. Fathers are great to tell the next generation, but so are neighbors like you. So that's the first story I want to tell you. And here's the second. Timothy. You ever heard the name Timothy before? If you look at an index of your New Testament, two of the 27 books are named after this guy, 1st and 2nd Timothy. He was perhaps the Apostle Paul's best friend and his closest co-worker in ministry. Timothy was apparently so strong in the Christian faith and so solid in what he believed and how he behaved that when it came to leaving a pastor to look over the church that Paul loved with his whole heart, the church at Ephesus, he tapped Timothy on the shoulder. But here's something you should know about Timothy. Acts 16 said that Timothy's parents weren't just from different cultures, Jew and Gentile, but they had different beliefs. And Timothy's father was not a believer. He wasn't raised by a great dad who taught him to pray to God and trust in God and love God. So where did Timothy's incredible faith come from? Here's my favorite passage of the day. It comes from 2 Timothy 1 verse 5, where Paul wrote, "I'm reminded of your sincere faith, which first lived in your grandmother Lois and in your mother Eunice, and I'm persuaded now lives in you also." Y'all remember those Sunday school stories about Lois and Eunice? No, me neither. But if it wasn't for those two women, there might only be 25 books in your New Testament instead of 27. Because they were the strong women in the faith who raised Timothy to be strong in the faith too. Everyone, but especially you ladies, write this down, that God doesn't just use fathers and neighbors, he uses mothers to reach the next generation. And I love that thought. You know, as pastors, we try to to walk this really, really hard tightrope when it comes to telling you about the power of a Christian father. Because we know that men so often they get infatuated with their careers and what's happening at work, and they forget about what's happening in their home and in the hearts of their kids. And so we never want to lose sight of that. And yet, as I sit here even now, I look out and I see some of you who are married and who are parents, but you don't have a strong Christian man sitting next to you. There's a ring on your finger, but you're spiritual on Sundays. And so when you hear us talk about fathers, sometimes I know, you've told me, it breaks your heart. You want him to be here, but it's not the perfect Christian family. You know, sometimes you get pregnant by a guy who doesn't love Jesus and he leaves and there's no dad to embrace that calling. And sometimes you get married and you had really hoped like he would follow you to the cross of Jesus and love Jesus as much as you, but you're not there just yet. And so when you read these passages, fathers, bring up your kids, it weighs heavy on your heart. Which is why 2 Timothy 1 verse 5 should be your life verse. Because Timothy's faith, his sincere faith, his faith that was so strong that in Acts 16, the other believers were buzzing. Have you met this kid yet? A faith so strong that Paul said, hey, I have to have someone to take over this church. I love Timothy. It's got to be you. Where did it come from? From a woman who loved Jesus and told the next generation. Which is why I took this selfie for you. This is like a crazy nostalgic picture for me because that is the hallway that I used to walk during every one of my pastor's sermons. That's a picture from St. Mark Lutheran Church in Green Bay, Wisconsin. And every Sunday when my pastor would get up to preach, I would tell my mom I needed to go to the bathroom. I didn't actually have to go to the bathroom. I just didn't want to hear the sermon. So if any of you kids tell your parents you have to go to the bathroom, I know what's happening. So I'm watching you. And I wouldn't go to the bathroom. I took a picture of this hallway because I would never walk like right on the middle. I would meander, right? That's probably the right verb. I would just like take my time and I was like I had gotten into the communion wine because I couldn't walk straight line. I would just mosey down the hallway. And actually just around the left, if you fishhook, was the boys' bathroom. And I'd go in there and I'd sit in the stall, even if I only had to go number one. And I'd just stare at the floor for a while. And I count to 100 in my head. And I look at the little tiles. I still remember they're about an inch by an inch, little gray, light blue. I learned if I relaxed my eyes enough, like little lines, like a magic eye kind of thing would happen. And then 10 minutes later, I'd meander and mosey back to my seat, and I'd sit down, and my mom dragged me to church. Sunday after Sunday, month after month, year after year. I used to actually, on Sunday mornings, I would pray to Jesus that my mom would have missed her alarm so that I wouldn't have to go to church. But then one day, you know what happened? What was a have to suddenly became a get to. And the sermons I used to duck out of, I used to stay and listen to. And the church my mom would drag me to, I started to attend even when she couldn't make it. And that new fire for Jesus led me to actually open this book and study it for myself. And suddenly when I was 16 years old, after planning my entire life to go to Madison and study business like my older brother and like my dad, I read a passage in this book that made me want to do this instead. My whole life was different because of that one passage where Jesus said, what good is it if a person gets the whole world and yet gives up their soul? And I walked into this church and I found out how to become a pastor. So do you know why I'm here today? Because of my mom. These days I'm absurdly blessed. My mom and my dad and my wife and my mother-in-law and my two daughters all come to church with us. My dad and I are severely outnumbered by the ladies in our family. But in those days, it wasn't all of them. It was just me and my mom. I didn't have a Lois and a Eunice. I had a Grandma Laverne and a Mama Judy. Sometimes all it takes, though, is a Judy to get you to a Jesus. And ladies, don't forget it. Maybe like my father, your husband will come to church when he's 60 years old. And maybe you'll raise the kid and sometimes it feels like you're dragging him and sometimes you wonder if he's really going to the bathroom and why it happens Sunday after Sunday, but you never know. You never know the day when the Holy Spirit will change that heart. You never know when the "do we have to" turns into the "can we get to?" And you never know if the kid that you raise becomes the one who will tell the next generation about Jesus. So ladies, do not give up hope. The sincere faith that exists in your heart can exist in the heart of the next gen. So that's the second story I wanted to tell you, which means we got one to go. God uses fathers, he uses neighbors, he uses mothers. And the last point I want to make to you is about this lady. Do you know her? I'll show you a picture. This is a PG-13 picture of many-breasted Artemis, the goddess of the Ephesians. I visited the city of Ephesus back in 2013. I brought this little statue at the gift shop. And if the sticker on the bottom is right, there used to be a massive statue that looked just like this in that city that was 9 feet tall. Because if apple pie is American, then worshiping Artemis was Ephesian. In that city, people were rabid for this religion. If you would read Acts chapter 19, you would find out that when the Apostle Paul showed up in Ephesus and he said she wasn't real and Jesus was, the place exploded. They tried to murder Paul for that claim. They actually rushed into this massive stadium and they shouted, they chanted for hours, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." Can you imagine the kind of passion they had for that religion? For 3 hours, they screamed it. Where I went to college, there were a bunch of college dudes who tried to repeat the experiment, and they walked around campus for hours trying to say, "Great is Artemis of the Ephesians." I think they made it 17 minutes before they got tired and gave up. I mean, these people had no time for Jesus. They did not believe in the God of the Bible. They worshiped her. Until one day, something changed. One day, a Christian church started in Ephesus. A church so important that the Apostle Paul spent 3 years in that city, his longest stop of any of his church plants. A church so important that Paul tapped Timothy with his sincere faith that he got from his mother to be the pastor of that church. And do you know how it happened? Do you know how people stopped worshiping her and started worshiping Jesus? It wasn't because of all the Christian dads in Ephesus. Let me show you my favorite thing that happened in that city. In Acts chapter 19, it says, many of those who believed now came and openly confessed what they had done. A number who had practiced sorcery brought their scrolls together and burned them publicly. When they calculated the value of the scrolls, the total came to 50,000 drachmas. In this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. Y'all remember the Sunday school story where the sorcerers burned their scrolls in Ephesus? How good is that? The sorcerers had a public scroll burning. Oh, 50,000 drachmas. If the math is right from the scholars, that's $8.5 million. They brought out their scrolls, and what did they do? They openly confessed the evil things they had done. And the passage says, in this way, the word of the Lord spread widely and grew in power. Which is my favorite thing I get to tell you tonight. That God can use sorcerers to reach the next generation with Jesus. Or maybe to put it more generically, you can fill in this last blank, that God uses sinners. I'm talking notorious sinners, unexpected sinners to reach the next generation. Which is what I love, 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 love about our church. You know, we don't have like a life group for sorcerers. And as many of your stories as I've heard, I've never heard that one, but do you know what I love about our church? Is that like those sorcerers, so many of you openly confess what you've done. And I'm going to tell you, our church has weaknesses and flaws, and there's things we really need to work on. But if there's one thing that I believe is like the secret sauce of our church community, is that we confess that we're sinners. Like not just generically and safely, okay, I confess, I'm not perfect, and I've sinned in like those generic categories, my thoughts, my words, and my deeds. No, what I love about so many of you is that when you come to church or when you join a life group, you actually talk about the messed up stuff you've done. And God has used that in such powerful ways. When I think about the dozens and dozens and dozens of people who come to our church from AA and NA and SA, when I think of those of you who have battled addictions and taken pills and been through depression and tried to kill yourself, when I think of those of you who've done time and who've prostituted your bodies and have had terrible things done to your bodies, and yet instead of like hiding and playing it safe, you talk about it. And instead of pushing people away from Jesus, it actually has the effect that Jesus intended, and it draws people to him. Instead of convincing our community that we're just a bunch of like terrible hypocrites and stay away from them, it makes people rethink what they've heard about the Christian faith. That what we do here on Sundays is not just a bunch of like good people who are trying to get a little bit better. So we are not just like holier than thou, but holiest than thou. No, instead we prove that the Christian church is about messed up people finding mercy at the cross of Jesus. And when you talk about your struggles, about your divorce, about your infidelity, when you talk about the things that you have seen online and the stuff that you really wish you could take back, when you openly confess that you have been so judgmental, maybe even racist or sexist or self-righteous, when we talk about that, we prove that Christianity is actually about Christ. That grace really is amazing because it saves wretched people like us. We let this community know that God can reach the next generation no matter who they are or what they've done or what their struggle has been. This is such good news. And it's so important that we keep talking like this. And we try to drum this into the DNA of our church. And it's always so scary when you sit in a new living room with a new group of people and you know it'll be so easy to pray for nice weather and grandma's surgery. And we want to push you to say no. Talk about your heart, your soul, your failures. Because I guarantee when you confess that sin, people won't take a step back and say, ew. They take a step towards Jesus and they say, me too. Me too. You put it all together. And you have the incredible book of Acts and this incredible thing that God uses to reach the church. I want you to know before you leave today, it's not just dads that have an incredible opportunity. It is the whole village that Jesus uses to raise up his Christian church. You might be a neighbor or a stranger like Ananias. You might be a grandmother or mother like Lois and Eunice. You might be a notorious sinner like the sorcerers from Ephesus. But the book of Acts, where Christianity exploded, proves that God uses the whole village to raise his church. Which is what I see when I look at you. You know, I look out at a church every single Sunday. I see a whole bunch of you who were raised by really great Christian dads and a whole bunch of you who weren't. In fact, I did some research this past week. I opened up our church software where we keep track of all the people who have officially become members of our church family. And I realized there is no one way that God has used to reach us. You know, she's here because of a coworker or someone she met at her gym. And she's here because she started dating a guy who grew up in a Christian family. She came because of the tireless work of her parents who would not give up in the midst of her addiction. He came because he fell in love with a pretty girl and would follow her anywhere, even if it was through the doors of a church. She came because her cousin invited her. He showed up because this pastor kept showing up at the gas station where he ordered his morning coffee. They saw the ministry on TV. They played soccer together. She was the foreign exchange student that just happened to be living in the home of two passionate Christians. They found out online. They started dating. They happened to end up at the same job. It was his boss or his employee, their next door neighbor, or his grandma that invited him. And I'm not just making up categories. I'm giving the examples of people who I'm looking at face to face. We are the proof in a very small corner of God's kingdom that he uses the whole village and every Christian to raise up his church. So brothers and sisters, let's do it again. There is an entire generation that is dealing with depression, anxiety, because they don't know the rock that is Jesus. They have no hope for eternal life and they are living for temporary things that will fail them sooner or later. So let's give them Jesus. Moms and dads, neighbors and strangers, you notorious sinners, it is time for us to let our light shine, confess our sins, and even more confess the incredible Savior who's rescued us from everything. Let's tell the next generation about Jesus. He's called us to do it. He's given up his Spirit. What a great mission for the great people of God. Let's pray. Ah, Jesus, we love you. Who else would love us as much as you? I love the fact, God, that when I get to the end of every single day, whether it was my best spiritual day or my absolute worst, there is your mercy and there is your cross and there is your grace. I thank you, God, that this isn't some man-made religion of some good rules and rituals where we try to earn our way to you. This is a gift and it's exactly what we need. God, I'm honestly scared sometimes for the next generation. I think of how many people are growing up and they're being shaped by something, but it's not the gospel and the good news of Jesus. But I know, God, I'm looking at the proof in church Sunday after Sunday that you don't have to obey the rules and you can be the God of surprises and exceptions. So surprise us, God. Bring people we would least expect. I pray that you would ignite the heart of fathers, that they would see of all the things for which they exist, nothing matters more than the next generation. I pray that we would believe that we don't just happen to be at work or at class or in a neighborhood next to these people by chance, but you have put us in that place and at this time that we could let our light shine, that people would see our good deeds and glorify you. God, we can't force anyone to believe, and we can't literally change a human heart, but you can. You can give people faith and hope at the cross of Jesus. So do what we can't and help us to tell the next generation the praiseworthy deeds of the Lord. It's in the Lord Jesus' name that we pray. And all God's people who wanted to reach the next gen, they joined their voices and they said, amen. Amen.
At this time, let's gather our offerings for the Lord. If you're visiting today, if you're a guest, please don't feel obligated to put something into the offering plate. We do ask, though, everyone fill out one of these cards. Some are green, some are white. Hand them toward the center aisle, and the ushers will gather them after they've gathered the offering.
To be, we give.
This morning in our prayers, we include two special prayers, a prayer of thanks for Jan Martin, successful brain surgery a week ago, and also a prayer for Madeline Hamm as she faces open heart bypass surgery this coming week. Please stand for prayer. Lord God Almighty, may your passion to save the next generation and every generation be our passion as well. Lord, we thank you for places in the community like The Edge, a coffee shop who's celebrating the 10th anniversary. Use us to be in places like that in our community, that we may be honest about our struggles, our sins, and use us to be those neighbors to share you with others, with every generation. Lord, we join Jan Martin in thanking and praising you for the successful brain surgery you gave her a week ago. Now on her road of recovery, Lord, continue blessing her that recovery may go quick and well. And as you bless Jan, so we ask you to bless Madeline Hamm, who is facing bypass open heart surgery this coming week. Lord, but grant success to those surgeons and all who care for Madeline, and grant her a good recovery as well. Now, Lord, hear us as we join together in the prayer that you have taught us. Our Father in heaven, hallowed be your name. Your kingdom come, your will be done on earth as in heaven. Brothers and sisters, go in peace. Live in harmony with one another and serve the Lord with gladness. The Lord bless you and keep you. The Lord make his face shine upon you and be gracious to you. The Lord look on you with favor and give you his peace. Amen.
With God.